Hello students, today we are going to start with very important topic, control and coordination. Now, what is control and what is coordination? Control can be of various types, control on hunger, control on your wish to go out at night, control on thirst, control on other urges that arise in this age. Coordination is an important term. Coordination is required in a family, in an office, in a unit, because if all factors, all components of a family or a unit do not work along with each other, then that unit will then there will be a problem. So we require both control and coordination, and in this chapter, my dear students, we are going to study about two types of control: nervous control and chemical control. Now for coordination, for understanding coordination, I'll give you one more example. Like when we are running, our heartbeat increases. And rate of breathing increases. Sweat glands become active. We start sweating because sweat cools down our body by evaporation. So all the body systems, they are working along with each other in a coordinated manner. So I hope you have understood what is control and coordination. Now, next part of our chapter is nerve cell or neuron, which is a unit of nervous tissue. Structure of neuron you have already covered in class 9th. So I'll just explain you with the help of a diagram. So this is the diagram of a neuron. Neuron consists of cell body, which has numerous small size processes which are known as dendrites, and there is a nucleus, large size nucleus in it, and then this one long process called axon with its axon terminals or nerve endings or axon endings. This axon is covered by myelin sheath except at places known as nodes of Renvier. Now if we talk about direction of transmission of nerve impulse, it's always from dendrite to cyton to axon, and then to axon terminal. This is favorite question of CBSC board. It's one-way transmission of electrical impulse, that is dendrite to cell body to axon to axon terminal. But what is the reason behind it? Why it is not two-way? Because in our electrical wires, electricity can be conducted in any way. But in nerve cells, it's always from dendrite to cell body to axon and axon terminal. Why? What is the reason? I'll explain to you in a short while. Now we come to type of neuron. We have sensory neuron, which are transmitting stimuli from sense organ to our central nervous system, that is brain and spinal cord. Motor neuron are carrying impulses from central nervous system to effector organ, that is muscle or gland. Then there are connecting or relay or interneuronal neurons which connect sensory and motor neurons found in gray matter. We have two types of matter in a brain, gray matter and white matter. Now, see, without mention of stimulus and response, our information will be incomplete. What is stimulus? Any change in external or internal environment of the body is known as stimulus, which will lead to a particular response in the body. Now, what is response? How we react or how our body reacts to that particular stimulus. Suppose if we happen to touch a hot object, we immediately withdraw our hand. So this is where withdrawal of hand is the response, and hot object, touching the hot object, is a stimulus. If we are feeling, if temperature outside is very hot, the sweat glands become active, we start sweating. Sweat, release of sweat by sweat glands is stimulus. And, this will be response. And hot temperature is stimulus. Now, how is this stimulus received by our body? This is by receptor. Receptor, the word is from reception, receiving. Something which is receiving about stimuli of outside or inside is known as stimulus. So is known as receptor. The receptor can be specialized tip of some nerve cell which detects the information from environment. These receptors are present in our five sense organs. In your NCERT, two receptors are mentioned, that is olfactory receptors and gustatory receptors. Olfactory receptor, these two are very important for board examination also. Olfactory receptors are related to perceiving the sensation of smell or olfaction. Gustatory receptors are related to perceiving sense of taste. Our tongue has taste buds which have gustatory receptors. Then in addition to this, our skin has many types of receptors, receptors of pain, receptors of touch, receptors of heat, receptor of pressure. Photoreceptors are present in our eyes, and phonoreceptors used for hearing are present in our ear. After receptors, now we come to our next important topic, which is synapse. Synapse is junction of two neurons. Whenever information has to pass from one neuron to another neuron, it has to pass through synapse. Synapse is a gap between neuron, one neuron, that is nerve terminals, or nerve endings or axon terminals of one neuron and dendrite of other. It's not like in like electricity wires in our home, which have to be connected in order to transmit current. But there is a wonder phenomena going on in our body. Our nerve endings of one neuron and dendrite of other neuron have some gap, which is known as synapse. Now, question arises: how does stimulus passes across this gap, children? This is also, now I'm explaining you answer to the question that we discussed a while ago, that why there is one-way transmission of electrical impulse in neuron. The nerve endings, they have special vesicles. You can see two such vesicles which are intact and another vesicle which is bursting now. Now these vesicles contain a special chemical known as neurotransmitter. Acetylcholine is one such chemical. Neurotransmitter is released in the gap, and this neurotransmitter so nerve endings have neurotransmitters. These neurotransmitters are released in the gap. Neurotransmitters will convert electrical stimulus to chemical stimulus. Chemical stimulus will stimulate the receptor present at the edges of dendrite of next neuron. This is how an impulse passes from one neuron to another neuron. Similar phenomena happens at neuromuscular junctions also. Now we come to discussion of next topic, that is parts of human brain. Human brain, which is a major controlling center of all the activities taking place in our body. It has three major parts: forebrain, midbrain, and hindbrain. Forebrain is highly specialized part. It's the most complex part of our body. And major part of forebrain is cerebrum. आप देखेंगे यहाँ से ये cerebrum जो यहाँ से लेके यहाँ तक, like from here it's extended till here, and it's the largest part of our brain. You can see the grooves and ridges present in this brain. Now these grooves and ridges are to increase the surface area to accommodate more number of neurons. Now function of the cerebrum is learning, thinking, analysis. All calculation that you do for mathematical sums or physics numericals is based on the information present in the cerebrum. It also controls voluntary actions of the body. Now comes a portion which normally students miss, that is association areas. There are separate areas of association in our forebrain where sensory information is interpreted by putting it together with information from other receptors, as well as the information or experiences stored in the brain. Based on this, a decision will be made how to respond. And this information does go to motor areas where control which control the movement of voluntary muscles. For example, our leg muscle. Suppose a cat is being chased by a dog. When cat sees a dog, then association areas will tell her that, oh, this is a dangerous animal. Last time also you had to suffer a loss because of this. So you need to run. So instruction to run is by association areas on the basis of previous experiences. Now we come to hypothalamus. Hypothalamus is responsible for chemical coordination, temperature regulation, hunger center, and it secretes releasing hormones. It is a thermostat of a body. Now, hypothalamus keeps the temperature constant in normal conditions, except in case of infection, when we suffer from a fever. Fever is because hypothalamus is set at slightly higher degree. So temperature of the body increases, it rises, and that higher temperature, it is a hindrance for multiplication of germs in the body. And hypothalamus also has endocrine role. It secretes certain release hormones, which will induce pituitary gland to release its stimulatory hormones. Now, pituitary gland, the master gland of the body, is endocrine in function. It secretes hormones such as follicle stimulatory hormone, FSH, TSH, thyroid stimulatory hormone, antidiuretic hormone, growth hormone, and some more. Growth hormone has special mention in your NCERT because this book is meant for growing children like you. Growth hormone is responsible for growth of bones and muscles. We shall discuss about it in detail in endocrine part. Now comes midbrain. Midbrain controls the motor movement, especially movement of eyes, and many involuntary actions are controlled by midbrain. Now comes the hindbrain. I think this is the favorite topic of CBSE board. The functions and parts of hindbrain. There are three parts. Cerebellum, which controls posture and equilibrium and maintain balance of the body. It controls precise actions of the voluntary type of actions. Precision of voluntary actions. Then medulla. Blood pressure, salivation, when you are seeing or thinking about some tasty food, you salivate. The mouth starts watering. That is being controlled by medulla, or sometime ulta pulta khake, or due to food poisoning, we suffer from vomiting. That is controlled by medulla. Then comes pons veruli. It controls the pons veruli, it controls some aspects of respiration, that's involuntary actions. Next part, the extension of our brain is spinal cord. Spinal cord is present in bony vertebral column of the backbone, and spinal cord has 31 segments. Each segment gives rise to a pair of nerves. These are known as spinal nerves. The nerves arising from spinal cord are spinal nerves. Nerves arising from brain are cranial nerves. Now it mediates most of the involuntary actions, reflex actions of the body. Then it conveys the information from sensory organ to the brain. Then it sends messages from brain to brain to effector organs like muscles or glands. Now the brain, which is very, very vital part of the body, how is it protected? There is a double layer protection. One layer is bone, that is cranium. Our brain is situated in a bony box known as cranium, and our brain is contained in a fluid filled balloon, which provides shock absorption. Brain has three meninges or the protective membranes. These are pyamator, arachnoid membrane, and duramator. In between these meninges, a fluid is filled, which is cerebrospinal fluid, which protects the brain from fluctuation in the blood pressure and also provides shock absorption. Now we come to next part, reflex action, which is a sudden, involuntary, automatic reaction to a particular response. When our hand touches a very hot electric iron, we just withdraw our hand within a flash of second. Now, all this does not require any learning. It does not require any learning or participation of brain at that time, though the information does go to higher sections of the brain later on. The path which is which is occupied by or which is covered by reflex action is reflex arc. There are components, that is receptor, which will receive the information, sensory neuron, which will pass on this information received by receptors to central nervous system, which has relay neuron, then will pass message to motor neuron will carry message to muscle or gland, and then muscle will contract, become short and thick, and causes movement. I can show you this flowchart: stimulus, sensory neurons, spinal cord, or in case of cranial reflexes, it is brain, then motor neuron and effector muscle. Now we come to next, muscle movement and nervous control. How do muscles show movement when they receive the nerve impulse? Muscles are special contractile proteins, actin and myosin. When a muscle receives an electrical stimulus, these actin and myosin filaments, they come closer and muscle changes its shape. It becomes short and thick, and this contraction of muscle brings movement in the related organ. This is how muscles show movement.